Threadlight. Written by Zack Argyle. Narrated by Adam Gold. Voice of War. Threadlight, Book 1. Chapter 1. A priest, dressed in ritual whites, placed a glove over each of his hands and reached out to the child on the altar.
May the will of the Father be manifest.
10 feet back, two couples stood staring, eyes eager with anticipation. Chris and Ariel were not family, but had been given the unusual honor of accompanying Luther and Emery for their son's rite of revelation. An honor Chris had tried to decline. Beneath the ritual chamber's domed ceiling, intricate stained glass windows graced the walls, and a hint of lavender lingered in the air. The room spread out in a wide circle. At the center stood a solitary marble altar with a handspan-high lip protruding from its four corners, forming a protective barrier for the squirming infant laying on its padded surface. To the side, a large veil masked a temple worker, set to record the events. The priest gently felt his way over the curves of the child's face, finding and opening the lids of the child's eyes. He lifted a vial out of his robes and forced a drop of clear liquid into the left eye. The child squirmed, but did not cry as the liquid settled over his iris. Chris stood with his hands behind him, his back straight and his head tall. His high general uniform was well pressed and orderly, but beneath his composed exterior, worry whittled away at his core. He'd seen the insides of men displayed on their outsides. He'd seen the life fade from limbless soldiers. But something about a child's discomfort unsettles a man's soul. Not to mention the enormous pressure this moment held for his friend. He looked to his wife, Ariel, and the mountain inside her dress, their soon-to-be-born child. Her hand was tucked below the mass, as if to keep it from falling. His own anxiety must be a drop of rain compared to the storm that raged inside Ariel. She wore her worry in the clench of her jaw. On the stone floor, an intricate design swirled around a painted gold triangle, the altar centered at its tip. Luther and Emery each stood at separate ends of the triangle. Chris appreciated the symbolism, but even more so, he appreciated the order.
What is the will of the Father?
The priest asked, his own eyes closed as he held the child's eyes open. Centuries ago, the Light Father himself had given his priests a chemical that served as a catalyst to hasten the reconciling of an infant's eye color. In a world where thread weavers defied the natural laws, eye color was everything. Today, it was even more important. Chris watched Luther and Emery step toward the altar. Ariel squeezed his hand. The room grew still. Emery choked on her breath and began to cry.
Brown,
she exhaled, trying to hold back her emotions. But that single word, so colorless, so ordinary, was a herald from which she could not hide. Achromic. Chris squeezed Ariel's hand as they soaked in the word. Having brown eyes wasn't the end of the world. It simply meant that you were not a thread weaver. Most people weren't, but Luther and Emery were. Their emerald eyes a sharp contrast to their dark, Phalian skin. Their first two children were as well. Emery buried her thick hair into Luther's chest. He gripped her fiercely, his eyes burning resentment. He took her hand and led her away from the altar. What came next would not be something any parent would choose to witness. Iriel's hand trembled against Chris's. He glanced over to see a tear falling down her cheek. She was a warrior, not one to cry, but pregnancy had a way of amplifying her emotions, especially in familial matters. He steadied her hand with his own. As they walked through to the waiting room, he grabbed Luther and embraced him, cursing the law under his breath. In Alkea, families were only allowed to have 2 children. If, however, a 3rd child was born, it was given to the church to be raised in the priesthood. Unless that child was a threadweaver. If the rite revealed blue or green eyes, the couple could keep their 3rd child. It was a risk Luther and Emery had known beforehand, and still, foresight dampens loss only the slightest. Chris held his friend tight. It felt wrong to see a soldier cry. If only he could convince the Stone Council to let them keep the child, or perhaps he could convince the Great Lord to grant an exception. Doubtful on both accounts. They'd known the risk in having a 3rd child. As they left the room, the sound of the recorder's pen scratching at parchment from behind the veil reverberated off the vaulted ceilings. It was done. Cursed to darkness, blessed to serve. Was that the priest's voice? Chris glanced back as the door closed behind them. The priest was holding a different vial now. A solemn echo carried through the hallway and into the waiting room as the door closed behind them.
What were we thinking? Luther asked.
He ran his hands over the bare skin of his head as he fought back tears. Chris shook his head.
You knew, and still you tried. That's damn brave if you ask me. I don't know.
Luther took a steadying breath.
Thank you for being here after everything we've been through. You know I'll always be there for you. You've had my back more times than I can remember. 2 threads, 1 bond. 2 threads, 1 bond, Luther repeated as they clasped arms. I should go. Emery's parents are waiting.
Chris looked him in the eyes. Get some time. Spend time with your kids. Take care of Emery. She'll need you more than you need her. I'll make sure any of your shifts are covered.
I know you're right. But the last thing I want to do right now is sit at home all day, replaying these moments in my mind. Chris,
Luther's eyes grew serious.
Promise me you'll let me know if anything comes up. If we can catch the blood thieves.
A blood-curdling scream thundered out from the ritual chamber. Every person in the waiting room turned to the door, terror-stricken. One by one, they each dropped their head. Cursed to darkness. Emery fell to her knees, wailing. Luther sank down with her. He squeezed her as they embraced the truth. The child they had known was no longer theirs. Chris could picture it in his mind, the priest injecting a few drops of acid into each of the child's eyes, the liquid entangling with tears as they bled down his face, a lifetime of divine blindness. It was cruel. It was horrid. It was commandment. All priests were blind in accordance with the Book of Alcaeus. And they shall shed off the light of the world for the light of Alcaeus, for it is greater to see truth than light. Chris and Iriel stepped away as Emery's family surrounded the couple. They walked silently, hand in hand. From the top of the temple's stone steps, Chris could see a broad view of the Alcaean landscape. The temple was nestled up against the Everstone Mountains, near the top of a large hill. A river flowed down from the mountains through the valley to the south.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.